Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Lutheran Church of Lakes. It's good to have you here. And Christmas season is done. But it's Epiphany, which is just as cool. Epiphany is when you don't just have great ideas, but it's when the world looked around and someone saw God in flesh. And that was the Epiphany, right? Oh my gosh, he's here. So today we hear from that classic Christmas. I know it's still a little Christmassy. The three wise men who traveled so far bearing their gifts, and in the end, they found the Christ. And then I'm going to talk about who they really were. Something interesting, I think. But before we get there, if you would please stand and join me as we begin our service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the sacrament of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. We confess. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins as a called and ordained servant of Christ. And by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God.
joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth.
Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, it is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The Lord has bared his holy arm before the eyes of all the nations.
Lift up your eyes all around and see they all gather together. they come to you, your sons shall come from afar, and your daughters shall be carried on the hip. Then you shall see and be radiant, your heart shall thrill and exult, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you, the wealth of the nations shall come to you, a multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah, all those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense, and shall bring good news, the praises of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read the gradual with me.
To us the child is born, to us the son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things.
Second reading is from Ephesians, the third chapter. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise of Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the power, by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given, to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God, who created all things, so that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
For so it is written by the prophet, and you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him. After listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. And they fell down and worshipped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise
college, I was attending Bible study there with the pastor who had just recently baptized me. And it was Christmas time, a little before Christmas break, so, you know, about a month earlier than it is now. And my pastor gave all of us young adults there a sort of fun Christmas-themed Bible questionnaire. The point of the questionnaire, he said, was to show how things so naturally become assumed that we assume they're in the Bible when maybe we're not exactly sure of what's in there. He wanted us to remember that we are about the Word, and that sometimes it's easy to forget what's actually in the Word. I thought, no big deal, I got this, right? I may be new to Christianity, but, you know, Christmas stuff, I know that pretty well. I've seen all the movies. See, every year for Christmas, I had this. My grandma made us read Luke 2. So between all the Christmas movies and Luke 2, I figure, I've got this quiz. I can do this. So all of us start going over the quiz quietly, just filling it out. It didn't take very long for the 20-some questions to have all of us, 12 college students or so, done. Sitting there very confidently, having a good chuckle about the whole thing, about, oh, that was fun, right? Easy peasy, no problem. And then the pastor started to go over the quiz's answers, and we all quickly started frowning. We had bombed it. I personally didn't get a single one of them correct. Not one. And I still remember some of those questions, so I'll share the 5 that I remember with you, and here's the first 4. What did the innkeeper say to Mary and Joseph when they arrived? Oh, yeah. Which animals were in the barn the night of Jesus' birth? Cows. I heard a lot of cows. A lot of mooing that night. On what animal did Mary and Joseph travel to Bethlehem? Not a cow, right? It was a donkey. And what did the angels sing to the shepherds in the fields? Glory to God in the highest. Whoever said it, that's what they sang, right? We all seemed pretty confident there, didn't we? I thought they were easy. But a lot of that actually comes from the tradition and the fun that we've put around Christmas. You see, the Bible actually doesn't say that much. So here are the answers. And don't worry, I'm right there with you. The Bible never mentions an innkeeper. Never mentions an innkeeper. So he might have said, booyah shakalaka, we don't know. It doesn't mention animals during the birth at all, probably because not important, I don't know. So there could have been a whole lot of mooing or no mooing. That donkey they rode to Bethlehem, fiction. Never mentioned the donkey. Now, they might have, or they might have walked, because it also doesn't say when they traveled. We always assume she was like about to give birth and about to pop that moment. We're hoping Joseph was smart enough to travel while she wasn't this shape. And finally, that angel choir wasn't a choir at all. They spoke those words, it says. We were baffled. Utterly baffled. There were 20 questions like that, and I got every single one of them wrong. I'm sitting here in this classroom wondering, oh my gosh, did I even know anything at all at this point? Now, don't get me wrong. It's completely okay to fictionalize parts of the story. It helps bring it to life. It helps build the reality of this very real event. And if nothing else, it's just fun. But there are some instances where the actual fiction is less cool than the reality. And today we have one of those as we celebrate the Epiphany of Christ. Now, the Epiphany isn't just someone having a really good idea, right? This isn't a eureka moment, or maybe it is. The Epiphany is there for when the world, this fallen place, someone in it realized, God is in flesh right here among us. And this year, we look to the wise men to do that. The ones who said, we're looking for the King. We're looking for God. He's somewhere, right? They had this epiphany, this realization. He's here. And these guys, those 3 wise men, they've become something entirely different thanks to all of the Christmas stories we've made. And they are so much more interesting in real life. See, the Bible doesn't actually say much about these mysterious people. We're not sure where they're from, except somewhere kind of over there. Right? So we don't know what country. But this is how we usually think of these people, right? These three wise men. We usually hold them in very high esteem, right? They say, oh, they were wise enough that they were able to travel thousands of miles to find Christ. They were able to triangulate the stars and do all this math, and in the end, their wisdom brought them to the very foot of the Lord. Ah, how good were they to go and meet and praise the newborn Christ. But that's not what the Bible actually says about them. That's what our stories say about them. See, those 20 questions back in college didn't include this one. It took a professor just a few years ago to point out one simple word in this text. And it changes the whole thing. I think it's a lot cooler, too. Before we get there, this question was on that quiz 20 years ago, and this is the fifth question I remember. How many wise men were there? We like to think three. We don't know. We just don't know. It's not in the text. Now, it could be because the Bible says they did bring three gifts, right? Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Very odd gifts to give a newborn mother, but there's a purpose behind it, and we'll get back to that. But see, the word used to describe these men, whatever number, we'll call them three because three is a lovely number. The word used to describe these three men is not wise men at all. It's magi. Magi. Now, that we hear that word sometimes. Sometimes we hear king. That's way off. That's not close. But magi. And it's where we get our words magic and magicians, which is already very different than wise men. And this word isn't used to describe guys like David Copperfield, right? This is something different. These men weren't really good at sawing women in half, and they had no intentions of making the Statue of Liberty disappear. The word magus, or magi for plural, describes something a little more nefarious. It's people who were learned in the mystical arts, who used magic more like witches did. Magic learning was their life's goal. They were astrologers and sorcerers who looked to the stars for answers. They sometimes communed and spoke to spirits, so they said. These guys were actually kind of weird. Now, how do we get to wise men? I'm not really sure. I think it's because they were deeply learned. They were very good at what they did, but they were very good at bad things. Mystical, not godly things. And yet Matthew used this word magi, magicians, sorcerers, to describe these traveling men. And any Jew or Christian that would have read his gospel back then would have said, magi? No, no thank you. They're raising the eyebrows, they're backing away, and they're saying, no, 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 that's not good stuff. Those aren't good people. These were the sort of people that a good Jew and Christian would tell their kids to make sure they stayed away from. Don't watch them. Don't talk to them. In modern terms, these were from House Slytherin, not Gryffindor. And honestly, I think this detail, this simple word change is awesome. It changes the story in such a beautiful way, and it brings us into it. Watch and see here. Because normally we say these wise men, thanks to their wisdom, are to be praised. Thanks to their wisdom, they arrived at Jesus and they figured it out. They were just so good. Except that we do not depend on wisdom and learning to come to Jesus. Jesus is followed only by the baptismal promise received by faith. It's faith, never wisdom, that actually brings us to Jesus. But if we remember that these magi are actually almost despicable sorcerers, and they're actually wayward sinners who watch the stars for answers, then we see something beautiful. Because realistically, these men were anything but wise in the way of God. They looked to the wrong things, looking to the stars for answers, depending not on God, but tricks and learning. They were actually the perfect example of the opposite of a faithful Christian, of a faithful Jew. They were the opposite of a good Israelite. And yet God took these despicable sorcerers and directed those heathens to his own son. Think of that. God somehow looked around the world, found the best example of the not following God crowd, and then he took them to his son. He guided them by sheer miracle in the night sky, these sinful, misguided men, to his holy and perfect son. The story of the Magi is not a story of what we should become, and it's not a story of what we should even be like. The story of the Magi is actually our story. It's in there so that God can show the world that he's going to find the worst people. He's going to use his power to bring them to God, to his son, Jesus Christ. The Magi are, unfortunately, like us. Sinners, looking to things other than God for answers. We turn to trust in money just as they trusted in stars. We seek our own knowledge and comfort in it just as they focused on their learning. We and the Magi are sinful people. And sinful people should have nothing to do with a perfect God. And yet God brought the Magi through the miracle of a star in the sky to his son. Just as he brings us to his son through the miracle of baptism. He brought sinners from the east, and he brings sinners from the dead into life in his son. So whether there were 3,000 or 6,000 Magi, it doesn't matter. They were representatives of this broken world. This misguided world and the misguided people in it. They were brought to Jesus as a symbol of what is to come, of God's work through Christ. God is basically setting the tempo. Hey, look at these horrible people. Look how I bring them in. And look how even they will recognize God. This isn't just for the Jews. This isn't just for the holier people. This is for the worst. And that's good because we're right there with them. It's a sign of Christ's work of saving the lost and forgiving the sinner. And these men, however many there were blessed to be among the first to arrive at Christ and not just see him as a newborn, but as the king of creation right here with us. And so, yeah, they brought their 3 gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They were gifts fit for a king, fit for the most important person they could find, and yet they were still so hollow. What could they actually bring the king of creation? And instead, they found Christ, and they received him. They received the true gift of Christ, these sorcerers with their physical hollow gifts. And they mark something important. In Matthew's gospel, they are the last people to acknowledge Christ as the king until Pilate jokingly gives him the name King of the Jews as he is dying. The next time Christ will receive any kingly gifts will be with nails, spears, and thorny crowns. And yet these men, sinful, misguided stargazers as they are, were the first in a long line of sinners to be saved. And today we are amongst that line. We've been brought out of the fallen world, just like the Magi, into the very presence of God. We are among them. We live in Christ. Not because we're so good, and not because we're so wise or smart or athletic or any of that, but because God has given us the miracle of faith and loved us enough to bring us to his perfect Son. You stand in the presence of Christ. Jesus Christ, the King of the earth. Trust in him and know that you were saved by a miracle. Amen. Now, if you would please stand and join me as we confess our faith in that Christ using the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God,
begotten of his Father before all worlds. God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated as we return our gifts to the Lord. Nancy Lavoie and Jeannie Yarger as they go through their challenges. Lord, for all those people who weigh on our hearts and minds with surgeries, cancers, pain, Lord, you name it, be with them, and please grant them healing. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we ask that the epiphany of your Son would be known around the world, north, south, east, and west. Lord, please include our state here and our church, the Church of the Lakes, that people would know you through us, but also through our other churches in Michigan, including Bethel, St. Mark, and St. Michael Lutheran churches. Father, let your light shine in this world, that our leaders in this country, in this state, may see it, and that they would be guided to your Son, just as the Magi were. We pray for President Trump and all of our officials, that they would follow your will. And Lord, we ask that you would protect all those many people in dangerous service of others around the world, both here and abroad. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, we offer up to you all of our doings and actions, prayers and thoughts this year at LCOL. Be amongst us in all of our interactions together and with people outside of here. Be in us with all that we pursue, that it would be to the glory of your name and to the mission of your kingdom that is the saving of souls. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, let your Son always teach us to pray as he has. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to give us eternal life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you. body of Christ given for you on the cross.
Strengthen and preserve you to life everlasting. Go in his peace. Amen. Welcome to the Lord's table.
Thank you.
come in the holy supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming we may, together with all your saints, celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.